this Wednesday service of First Baptist Church in Lucedale, Mississippi. I know you join me in praying for conditions in our country, asking that God would move and work in the lives of people, in the lives of our leaders, in the lives of the people on the street, and those of us who are in our homes who are watching. Has anyone ever put you on hold? You placed a telephone call and then you found yourself on a long hold and you just kept waiting and waiting and waiting. How long will you wait before you hang up? What about when God puts you on hold? Has that ever happened? How long will you wait when the call you've made to God is a 911 call and the situation is desperately urgent? How many of you are waiting on God right now? Did anyone in the Bible ever experience waiting on the Lord? Well, the answer to that is yes, and it's been the practical experience of God's people down through the generations. God never operates according to our calendar. One of the most dismal moments in our married life was one of those times when we were waiting on the Lord. We lived in Louisiana. I was the pastor of a small church. We lived on a dead-end road. The church was on a dead-end road in the middle of the woods. Now it's part of that whole area is part of a park in a state park in Louisiana. And so it was lonely down that road. Nobody ever came down that road. And so we were sitting in our house one day. I don't remember what day it was. We had two little children, one maybe five, one maybe three. It might have been a little bit before that. And so there was a knock at our door. And that knock at our door happened to be John and Ruth Merck, who at that time, Brother John was a pastor in Louisiana in the Baton Rouge area. Brother John was my pastor growing up in my early years, and he had baptized me. And I don't even know how he found us. I don't even know how he knew where we were. He'd never been to our house before. But they showed up at our house that day, and the situation, the circumstances, even in our den that day, in our living room, the little house where we were just so discouraged. And we've been waiting on the Lord, asking the Lord for some deliverance. We love the little church where we were, but the situation was the church budget, this was 1982, the church budget for the entire church was $16,000. That paid all the bills of the church and paid my salary, which was in 1982. I had 7 years of post-high school education, including a master's degree, and my salary was $175 a week. My car payment was $175 a month, and the rest of that was left for us to live on. The Lord was taking care of us, but we were in a waiting period, and we were just waiting for that moment when the Lord would come through. And it didn't seem to us that he ever was going to come through and we would ever be able to move to another place or have another opportunity. And so there I was. And then there was this knock at the door. It was Brother John and Miss Ruth. And Brother John said something to us that day I have never forgotten, and I never will. He said, "Eddie, God may be slow, but he's never late." Well, it's true. God is sometimes slow when we're looking at our watch or the clock on the wall or our calendar. We still waited for some months before there was ever any sign of God's activity. And then one day I got a telephone call, and it was a man who called himself C.W. Brown. He said, "I'm from Agricola Baptist Church in Agricola, Mississippi, and our church is looking for a pastor." And now you know the rest of the story. That's how the Lord brought me to Agricola. That was God's answer from that long waiting period. But we're not the only ones who have ever had such struggles. We see them surface in Scripture. We see God's people wondering, where is God and why is it taking him so long? Tonight, we're going to look at David's own experience of waiting on God and the testimony he gives of God's response. This is from Psalm 40, verses 1 and 2. Psalm chapter 40, verses 1 and 2. I'm going to read those verses to you. David said, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He brought me up out of the pit of destruction, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock, making my footsteps firm. Well, obviously, the first thing we see from these two verses is that David was waiting on God. Waiting on God is never easy, but notice where David waited. The King James Version calls it a horrible pit. The New American Standard Bible calls it a pit of destruction. The New Living Translation calls it a pit of despair. Have you ever been in one of those places? David was in a horrible pit of a predicament. He was in serious trouble. He was in serious need of God's help. He was sinking in the miry clay, the quicksand of some hopeless situation. Time was running out. David placed a 911 call to God, and God put him on hold. The longest days you'll ever spend are the days that you spend waiting. Time drags by at a snail's pace. Waiting in the doctor's office for an hour can seem like forever, but waiting on God when the situation is urgent can place a strain on your faith that's incredible. So in this set of circumstances, David found himself waiting on God, and remember, he was waiting in a horrible pit. How would you respond if it happened to you? If that pit had been a physical place, David might have tried to claw his way out. He might have tried to scream his way out, trying to get someone else's attention who would help him. Sometimes we act in similar ways to our own horrible pit of a predicament in our circumstances. We try to climb out on our own strength. We call to friends or seek help from other places when we grow weary of waiting on God. No one wants to stay forever in a horrible pit of a predicament. So how did David respond? Well, he cried out to the Lord and he waited. Horrible pit may be the term that you use to describe your present circumstances. You've placed a 911 call to God, and now it seems that God has put you on hold. The second thing that we see about David and his prayer in this time when he was in the horrible pit and he waited on God, David didn't panic, even though it seemed that his cry for help from God had been put on hold. David said, I waited patiently. Are you waiting patiently on the Lord? Patience isn't easy when you're in a horrible pit of a predicament and you're up to your neck in the quicksand of hopelessness. You're in a world of trouble and God seems to be silent. That's when you want to look for your own way out. You want to climb the walls. And as the pressure and stress of the situation builds and God delays his answer, the temptation becomes ever greater to use your own wisdom to devise your own plan and to make your own decisions. But David didn't. Rather, David chose to wait on God. How long are you willing to wait on God? Did you know that mice and men have something in common? We both like cheese, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm sure you like cheese and I like cheese too. We both have a circadian rhythm. It's an internal body clock that tells us when to go to sleep and when to get up. For several years, I made mission trips to Romania, and going to Romania required us to take an 8-hour flight across the ocean and then another 2.5-hour flight across Europe. And so our days and nights would easily get mixed up. And if we wanted to be able to sleep in Romania, they advised us to take a couple of melatonin tablets for a few days before we went to Romania at the time that we would be going to sleep in Romania, so our brains would begin to get set for that time, and to do the same thing when we came home. We had to reset our body clock. Spiritually, we have another kind of clock. It's a clock that tells us it's time to give up on God. It's time to hang up when we've made that 911 phone call to God and he put us on hold. Well, melatonin may help reset the body clock, but a dose of faith can help reset our spiritual clock. We often give up on God when we face difficult circumstances. We get a strong urge that we need to take matters into our own hands. Waiting, from our perspective, is inactivity. It's irresponsible. But when we are waiting on God, it is a vigorous exercise of our faith. A marathon is a 26.2-mile run. Marathoners can run all those miles without stopping. Not only can a good marathon runner run those miles without stopping, the best of them can maintain a pace through those 26 miles for every mile that you and I couldn't even run for 1 mile. Their hearts and lungs are conditioned for endurance. Well, in the Christian life, you and I need a faith that's conditioned for the long run. We need a faith that will wait on God, whether it's in a short wait, whether it's a short wait in an easy place, or whether it's a long wait in a horrible pit of a predicament. One thing that can make a horrible pit of a predicament even worse is to act without waiting on God. So you're in a horrible pit of a predicament of your own. You've placed an urgent 911 call to God, and apparently He's put you on hold. If you shouldn't panic, if you shouldn't allow the pressure to convince you to seek other options, if you shouldn't take matters into your own hands, what should you do? Well, you should wait on the Lord. Consider how David waited on the Lord. First, he waited confidently. Psalm 27:14, David makes this suggestion to us. It comes through the Holy Spirit, from the Lord to your heart and mind, mediated through the pen of David. He said, "Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Yes, wait for the Lord." Waiting on the Lord is confident trust that God will come through. The Old Testament prophet Micah wrote in Micah chapter 7, verse 7, "Therefore, I will look unto the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me." That is waiting confidently. That is the faith of a heart confident in God in spite of any perceived delay. A heart that knows the character of God will wait confidently in a pit, in a problem, or in a predicament of any kind, depending on God's unfailing faithfulness. So David waited confidently. Not only so, we've already observed that he waited patiently. He said, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry." Waiting on the Lord sometimes means watching the deadline approach on our calendar, and then dreadfully to our souls, watching that deadline pass without any word from God. Is that where you are? Is the bill still not paid? Is the problem still unsolved? Are you waiting anxiously, or are you waiting patiently? Faith continues to wait on God beyond some perceived deadline with steadfast confidence that the Lord will answer. Faith waits on God on the short, pleasant roads or in the marathon wait in a horrible pit. So David waited confidently. He waited patiently. Third, he waited comfortably. Look at what he said. In Psalm 37, verse 7, David wrote, "Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him." We need to learn to wait without fretting, without climbing the wall of our pit, without seeking ways out of our circumstances. We need the confident faith that God knows where we are and what we face. Are you resting in the Lord? Are you waiting confidently, patiently, and comfortably for His help? I think of resting in the Lord like resting on a mattress. You know, when you lie down on a mattress to go to sleep at night, you place your absolute confidence in that mattress and in the frame of that bed that it's going to support the weight of your body. Resting in the Lord is trusting Him to carry us and the weight of our problem. It is a refreshing rest and trust in the greatness and faithfulness of God. So David waited confidently, he waited patiently, and he waited comfortably. He rested in the Lord, and he waited faithfully. In Scotland, in the city of Edinburgh, there's a statue of a little Skye Terrier, a little dog. In 1858, the owner of the two-year-old dog died. The little dog accompanied the funeral procession to the final resting place of its master. And after everyone was long gone from the cemetery and the grave was covered, the little dog crawled to the foot of the grave and lay there. And it appeared to everyone that he was expecting the return of his master. And amazingly, the little dog waited day after day. It waited through all kinds of weather. People would capture the dog and take him home, but the dog always escaped and always returned to the grave of its master. Do you know how long that little dog waited? Well, the tale is that the dog waited no matter how many times it was delivered from the graveside, carried back to its home. The dog waited there faithfully for 14 years until it died. If a little dog can be that devoted to its dead master, then you and I should be able to wait confidently, patiently, comfortably, and faithfully for our Lord, expecting him to answer. So some of you are in a position of waiting on God. You've placed that 911 call to God, and it seems that he's put you on hold. But consider David. David cried out to God, and God, in his tenderness, bent down and responded to David's waiting faith. David's ultimate deliverance is a tangible indication that God heard, but God heard prior to that deliverance, even though it didn't come immediately. You and I need to have a faith that God always hears and answers, but he does so in his timing and not our own. Remember, God may be slow. He may not be working according to your clock or according to your calendar. He may seem slow to you, but he's never late. God always comes through, works out problems in the way he chooses to, and everything God does is for your good and for his glory. I want to thank you so much for listening. I pray that God would bless you through this week, meet all your needs, and answer you quickly. Thank you so much for listening.